Hidden traces of the past and extraordinary locations of the present in this episode of Mystery Places. The most spectacular lost places in the USA. Total control in the city of the future, Songdo Smart City. Adventurous photographer Thomas Windisch explores an abandoned ex-Yugoslav airbase. In India, we encounter strange places with unusual people. In China, there is a place that is on fire all the time. All of this now on Mystery Places. We are in Tucson. Our journey of the most spectacular lost places in the USA starts here. In the bunker with a nuclear missile, 300 times more powerful than the one that destroyed Hiroshima. Heading into the astonishing industrial ruins of Detroit. And on a visit to an abandoned gold mining town near the Mexican border. Our three lost places in the USA. We start off in Tucson, Arizona. A deadly relic with incredible destructive power is said to be found here. 1963, at the height of the Cold War, the nuclear superpowers USA and the Soviet Union built missile launching bases capable of wiping each other out, in fact, several times over. Former commander Yvonne Morris opens the gate for us to precisely such a missile base. There was surprisingly little security and no guards above ground here. They would only have appeared in case of an alarm.
There's a lot of concrete between anybody up here and actually getting to the missile or getting to the crew in the launch control center.
And that is precisely where the former bunker commander is now taking us. Two teams of two always work 24 hours in a row under the ground. The teams would alternate every 4 hours.
Actually, I didn't miss the sun when I was down here. I didn't have any feeling of claustrophobia at all.
The bunker is located almost 15 meters below the surface and is surprisingly small. A 100-meter-long connecting tunnel leads to the missile silo. Although the bunker would not have withstood a direct hit, that was also highly unlikely because the nuclear missiles of that era were not so accurate. Passing by 30-centimeter-thick steel doors and up to 2.5-meter-thick concrete walls, Yvonne leads us into the inner sanctum, the command room. From here, she could have triggered a nuclear catastrophe, and to think she was only in her mid-20s.
Having the responsibility that we had was a burden. What I did is I used the possibility of Armageddon to motivate me, but I didn't dwell on it. I focused on the day-to-day activities that we had to do here and our daily mission of keeping the missile ready to launch on a moment's notice.
The command to do so would have come via radio and would have sounded like this. Only the American president could have authorized the release of the nuclear weapons. In this case, a code matching the code deposited in the safe would have been transmitted. The crew would have then entered the launch code and would have had to turn two keys simultaneously.
Once we turn our keys, we've started something that we can't stop. There's no oops switch down here.
The 740-ton concrete cover would have then rolled back to release the missile. 54 such stations were distributed throughout the United States, each with a range of over 15,000 kilometers and an explosive power of 300 times the Hiroshima bomb. Within 30 minutes, they could have destroyed any city in the former USSR. Each station had three pre-programmed targets.
I did think about what would happen if we ever had to launch our missile, and they were not very happy thoughts. It would mean that life, as we know it, is over.
This is also true for the bunker crew itself, because a launch would have meant the Third World War. The crew of four could have survived here on their own for another 30 days. That was all the water, food, air, and electricity they had.
But in the end, the crew is probably not going to have to worry about that at all. Because even though we successfully launched our missile, we failed in our mission.
That is peace through deterrence. The missile's very existence was intended to deter the other side from firing their own nuclear weapons. A dangerous game. For 20 years, the nuclear missile was always ready for launching. The emergency case scenario fortunately never arose. Today, the silo is merely an empty shell. From the secluded Arizona desert, we now head off to the metropolis of Detroit in the north of the United States. The automotive industry once made this city rich. Today it is bankrupt. Thousands of buildings stand abandoned and dilapidated. The ruins which are found on every corner now attract tourists. The annoyed locals refer to this as ruins porn. Jesse Welter has made it into a business. He offers photo tours and sells his own pictures. Not exactly a safe job.
Yeah, you wouldn't want to go into the wrong building in the wrong neighborhood, or into a building that's maybe not structurally safe. And there's always dangerous.
That's why we first drive to Easttown Theater. Criminals are said to hang out here when the sun goes down. The cinema was opened in 1931, with what was then a gigantic auditorium. In the 1970s, the building was home to a famous rock and roll club.
A lot of big rock bands played here. And they had capacity of like 1,700 people, but they was known for packing them in to like 3,000 people, being over capacity. So this is where you came to see Alice Cooper, you know, Fleetwood Mac, The Kink, Yes, all the big bands. This is where they came to play.
Today, this lost place provides a stunning backdrop to Jesse's photos. The wild excesses were always a thorn in the city's side. When on top of it all, excessive raves began to be held here in the 90s, the joint was finally closed down and is now in danger of collapsing. A fate that many abandoned buildings in the city share today. Detroit was once the heart of the American auto industry. Almost 1.9 million people lived on 370 square kilometers in 1950. Since then, however, things have deteriorated due to structural changes in the auto industry and ethnic clashes. The population shrank and the crime rate rose. Today, the most dangerous city in America has only 681,000 inhabitants. That is why there are so many huge vacant car factories here. Like the next building Jesse shows us. Neighbors often call the police here when they see unauthorized people on the premises. Caution is thus advised.
All right, we'd make a scoop for that door right there.
Although the building is actually owned by the city, penalties hardly deter anyone here. Many young people use the ruins for hanging out and skateboarding.
This is a skate park. The floor collapsed, and then now the kids use it as a skate park. And it's been rumored that Tony Hawk has come here and skated in here.
Body parts were once manufactured and car doors painted here. Although at first glance the factory today looks totally normal, the architecture was revolutionary for its time.
Mostly notorious for his column design, be able to get the most weight per floor. So when he built these columns, you could put a lot more weight per floor and you could go and build your building up higher. And you'll see like some of the windows are all blue glass, you know, and that he knew that would, for the workflow, it creates, you know, it opens up creativity, it puts people in a better mood, that kind of thing. So that's another part of his design.
The factory closed in 1984 as the order situation was getting worse and worse. Now a foreign investor is interested in the building for conversion to luxury lofts. Pure luxury once prevailed in Lee Plaza. Built on the outskirts of the city in 1929, It was once a hotel and apartment complex.
No money was spared. It was the best of everything, you know. Like here, we're standing in the ballroom right now, and they would have had a grand piano here. You can see how ornate the ceiling, the architecture is. Nothing but the best was the idea.
When the guests stopped coming, in 1969, the city started using it as a retirement home. In 1997, it was closed, and all the entrances were boarded up. It was not long until the metal thieves broke in, stripping the former luxury hotel down into a ruin. Nothing is left of its former splendor. Although downtown Detroit is now seeing a lot of construction, it will be a long time before things pick up on the outskirts again. Unlike our third lost place, which will always be a ruin. Only 4 kilometers from the Mexican border, far from any sign of civilization, we visit one of the best preserved ghost towns in the South. Ruby Mine was a boom town in the early 19th century. After lead, zinc, copper, silver, and especially gold were found here. We meet a woman who grew up in the small town. We accompany 84-year-old Talia Primer Cahoon on a visit to her old home.
This was a bedroom, and my parents' bed was here, my brother's bed, my sister's bed. My youth bed that I still have, incidentally, was right here. And my dad, there was nothing to do out here after work, and so he started building furniture. So he built a closet, and it fit right here.
Her father, a mining engineer, moved to the city in 1926. 3 years later, his first daughter, Talia, was born. When she was 5, her father took her to his workplace in the mine for the first time.
I was so excited because I was coming to work with my dad. I looked around and my thinking was, why are there people down here when they could be outside in the sunshine? And that ended my mining career. I knew I didn't want to work in a mine someplace.
The small town has been deserted for 75 years now. Back in its heyday, however, 1,200 people used to live here. So many that the mine had to erect hundreds of tents in addition to the 32 houses. This made Ruby the biggest mine in the area. Workers toiled around the clock in 3 shifts. The machines ran night and day, making an unbearable racket. Due to its proximity to the border, the little nest soon also began to attract criminals.
There were a couple of murders that took place here, and we'll go in and I'll show you. 1920, 2 men came into the store. Alex turned to the register to make change, and he was shot and killed. And his brother came downstairs, and he was shot and killed. The two perpetrators of the crime escaped.
The killers were arrested only after a large-scale police hunt. The Wild West in Arizona. Civilization gradually started making inroads into the small town, however. There were even plans for a pipeline to bring running water. But Ruby's mine success story was short-lived.
The reason that it's abandoned is because the ore began to give out in 1938, so families started leaving, so Ruby was just left as it is. Because if there's no ore, there's no work.
Not a soul has lived in the former mining town in the last 75 years. Wind and weather have left their mark. Soon nothing will be left of this desolate place. From America's lost places, we go to the most modern city in the world, Songdo City in South Korea. Here, everyone lives in smart homes and control their entire daily life through one smart card. Everything in the city is controlled from a huge control center. The traffic is continuously monitored. Songdo is a city with a computer mastermind. Is this the future or total surveillance horror? Will we all soon be living like this? Songdo is located near Seoul. The city was designed from scratch. 10 years ago, there was nothing here. 500 million tons of sand and $40 billion later, the city of the future was complete. Songdo is referred to as a smart city, an intelligent city. By 2020, 250,000 people should be living and working here. And what is it like to live here?
누구세요?
네, 안녕하세요. 독일에서 온
사람입니다. 네, 알겠습니다.
Electronically locked doors and touchpads are used to control her apartment. Su Jong-chung lives in a smart home. Although gradually becoming established in Germany, it is already standard technology in Songdo. Here, every apartment is equipped with state-of-the-art technology.
저희가 전기 얼마를 썼는지 가스 이런 거를 전반적으로 확인해 볼 수 있습니다. 그래프 보기도 가능하고요. 현재 저희가 1월 달, 2월 달 이 정도. 그다음 월별 얼마를 썼는지 이런 게 되고요. 택배 3일, 2일 날 도착한 택배요. 저희가 한번 확인해 볼게요.
Everything is optimized and automated in Songdo, even rubbish disposal. Su Jong-chung can only open the rubbish bin flap using a smart card. This allows city administration to keep track of what he throws away.
저희는 우리 쓰레기를 뭐 따로 이제 보통 이제 날짜를 정해서 음식 쓰레기를 버리고 이랬는데 앞에 살던 데서는 그런 거는 뭐 데이터 뭐 이런 거는 모르겠고 언제든지 쉽게 버릴 수 있으니까 그거는 편해요.
Rubbish is further processed underground. Dustbin lorries are nowhere to be found in Songdo. That is also part of the concept. Rubbish is transported out of the city to collecting point via a pipe system.
아, 우리가 지금 계획한 쓰레기 양은 음식 일반 합쳐서 27톤 정도 되고요. 그다음에 그 쓰레기 이송 속도는 초당 20에서 30m로 이송을 하고요. 그다음에 우리 주 관로가 깔려 있는 곳은 약 한
These six giant turbines take care of this. At the moment they have been turned off as the noise would otherwise be unbearable.
청소기 청소기를 청소기 원리하고 같은 건데 청소기는 뒤쪽으로 쓰레기가 그 엔진 부분으로 쓰레기가 저기 몰리듯이 저희 집화장도 입구에서 주민이 쓰레기를 버리면 여기까지 이 송풍기를 거쳐서 이 뒷단에
No loud dustbin lorries in the morning. The rubbish is disposed of quietly here. Downtown, residents can reach any destination in 10 to 15 minutes on foot, according to city planner Scott Summers.
We learned that over 15 minutes of walking, people will tend to jump in their cars or hop in a bus. So that's the reason we put the park in the middle and the buildings on the outside is to try to keep that walkable distance to about 15 minutes.
Songdo is also designed for future growth. A luxury many old cities do not have. A large green space in the middle of the city is especially unusual in Asia. Here we meet Kim Min-jong's family. They moved here from Seoul for the better quality of life.
네, 송도에 와서 일단 아이들을 키우는 입장에서는 안전하고 그런 부분은 훨씬 더 삶이 인 아웃 차량을 다 알 수 있어요. 그래서 어떤 일이 있어도 대응할 수 있다는 생각이 들고요.
Visitors to the city are recorded? Yes, that's right. In Songdo, cameras monitor everything that happens within the city limits. The whole system is cross-linked. All the cameras in the city are connected to a unique control center, Songdo's computer brain. On the 20-meter-long wall of monitors, those responsible can see everything that happens in Songdo. Kim Jong-won is the master of the masses of data that arrive here and are evaluated.
이곳은 이 부분은 유교통 시스템을 보여주는 곳으로 아이페즈의 환경에 관련된 이산화탄소, 오존 이 가운데 있는 것은 UCT에 설치되어 있는 다양한 시설물들의 상태 정보들을 실시간으로 도시민의 안전들을 실시간으로 24시간 모니터링하는 방범 서비스를 보시고 있습니다.
It's an incredible surveillance effort. 500 cameras and measuring stations collect data on all possible aspects of life. How's the traffic? How clean is the air? And is a crime being committed somewhere at this moment? This allows city managers to react quickly and efficiently to congestion, crime, and weather. The system can even find parking offenders on its own.
시스템으로 이 번호를 자동으로 인식해서 저희 시스템에 저장하게 됩니다. 그렇게 되면 이 불법 주정차를 담당하는 그 단속 기관에 이 정보들을 보내서 이 부분에 대한 과금이라.
The city of the future keeps track of everything. Whether this gives you a sense of security or scares you is something everyone must decide for themselves. In Songdo, information can be retrieved on every street and every house. This should allow the city to be managed more efficiently.
사실 예전 같은 경우는 어떤 시설물이 문제가 생겼거나 사건이 있을 때는 현장에 직접 나가보거나 그런 속도 부분, 효율성, 도시 관리의 효율성을 증가시킨다는 부분에 있어서 큰 장점이 있다고 말씀드릴 수 있습니다.
A city with a mastermind that knows everything about its inhabitants. Songdo also has a citywide telepresence network. Here, every household can, on request, use the same technology that companies normally use for global video conferencing. Sujeon Chung uses it every day for teaching beauty courses.
안녕하세요. 네. 여기 이거 재료 중에 해면 보이시죠?
Working in front of the TV. For the trained cosmetician, it is a good way to earn money without a lot of setup effort.
저희가 여러 사람을 한꺼번에 같이 만날 수 있는 뭐 시간 같은 것도 전략이 될 수 있고요. 그리고 뭐 피부 뭐 스킨케어 이런 뭐 관리 받으면은 금액이 좀 고가인 경우가 많잖아요. 그런 거를 이제 저렴하게 저희가 집에서.
Always sitting at home? Is that what the future looks like? Version 3.0 of the Information Office is also already available in Songdo.
네.
The lady on the other end also gives restaurant tips or checks the train and bus schedule by video conference. U-Life is the name of the company behind this. They plan to do as much as possible by video conference in the future. Technology is used early on here. For example, every child has an iPad that they use in the classroom. And technology companies like Cisco are tinkering with even more surveillance. For the little ones, for example, Charlie Nam shows a tracking system for children, which raises an alarm as soon as a child leaves a specified area.
And we can track the kids in their lifetime. And in the meanwhile, we can also track the kids with the surveillance camera. So once we pass the position that we can pop up the surveillance camera.
Good for worried mothers, but what does the child think of it? The advantage of a networked city. In just a few minutes, a missing person report can be displayed on screens in department stores, information boards, and metro and bus stations. Koreans seem to feel comfortable and safe in a completely surveyed city. Will our cities also look more and more like Songdo in the future? Many things are modern and practical here, but round-the-clock surveillance is also kind of scary, is it not? From the most modern city in the world, we go to Bosnia and Herzegovina. Photographer Thomas Windisch takes us to see unusual attractions.
Man sieht da zum Beispiel Einschusslöcher.
When traveling with the Urban Explorer, you must be ready for anything.
Kann die Decke jetzt nicht einstürzen?
Die Decke kann jederzeit einstürzen.
Thomas Windisch is packing for his new expedition. the most important travel items, everything to ensure his safety and ours, such as a first aid kit and a headlamp. We are more than a little astonished when he tells us to pack flares as well.
Was andere Funkgerät kriegst du?
Why do people go on holidays that are so dangerous they even need respiratory masks?
Na, es gibt dort, wo wir hingehen, einen gewissen Teil an Radioaktivität. Es gibt chemische Verbindungen in der Luft und die sollte man nach Möglichkeit nicht oder nicht allzu lange einatmen.
Und wieso fährst du dann dahin?
Weil es interessant ist und spannend ist.
Aber gefährlich?
Ja, aber man kann sich ja entsprechend darauf vorbereiten. Also jede Minute an Vorbereitung verringert eigentlich das Risiko, das man dann dort hat.
Thomas is a photographer, a so-called urban explorer. He photographs abandoned places that hardly anyone remembers anymore. Orphaned buildings have a very special beauty for the motif hunter. The tour takes us to the border region between Croatia and Bosnia. There was a war here in the 90s. That is why there are still abandoned military facilities belonging to the Yugoslav People's Army.
Wir fahren jetzt zu einer verlassenen Airbase, die komplett in den Berg hineingebaut ist. Und vorher müssen wir uns noch bei der Grenzpolizei anmelden, weil wir eine Genehmigung brauchen.
Warum?
Weil diese Airbase direkt an der Grenze liegt und dort auch immer wieder Schmuggler durchkommen und sonstige Dinge passieren.
Our destination is one of the abandoned military installations right on the border between Croatia and Bosnia. Let's see whether the authorities will let us in. We try to obtain a permit without showing our camera and are successful.
Ja, der Grenzbeamte hat gesagt, wir sollen nicht in das Gras gehen, weil dort Minenfelder sind. Und aufpassen, dass wir nicht die Grenze in die bosnische Richtung überqueren.
Okay, das klingt ziemlich gefährlich.
Ja, ist kalkulierbares Risiko.
But we are still feeling rather queasy. We continue driving eastwards. Thomas wants to show us the largest underground hangar in Europe. An abandoned underground military complex like in a James Bond movie. It cost $6 billion once upon a time. But what's left of it?
Wir werden heute wirklich ganz tief in den Komplex vordringen. Also wir sind hier beim Eingang Nummer 3. Diese Schott ist dicht, das heißt, wir kommen nicht durch den Haupttunnel. Das heißt, wir müssen durch diese kleinen Versorgungsschächte und Räume durchgehen, dann nach links.
Dann sind die offen, die Schächte?
Das werden wir sehen, wenn wir drinnen sind. Ja, wichtig ist auf jeden Fall, etwas Abstand zu halten, falls wirklich irgendwo was runterkommen sollte, dass es blöd gesagt nicht alle erwischt, sondern nur einen. Ganz wichtig, doppelt und dreifach, Licht, Batterien immer griffbereit haben und zusätzlich kriegt dann auch jeder ein Knicklicht. Mhm. Dieses hier.
Was mache ich damit?
Falls wirklich alles ausfällt oder alles ausgeht, haben wir immer noch zumindest ein bisschen Licht, das wir rausfinden oder dass wir Batterien wechseln können.
The US Army also uses such light sticks on missions. Another safety precaution. Thomas informs a friend at home about our tour.
Servus. Wir gehen jetzt rein.
If we have not reported back by the agreed time, the rescue service will be informed.
Um 9 Uhr ist dann Deadline.
The cavern we are about to enter is dangerous. The soil is supposedly covered with toxic and even radioactively contaminated dust.
Ja dann, Masken auf und los geht's.
Our lamps are the only source of light in a strange underground world. We can hardly see what we're stepping onto. To be on the safe side, we decide to use the glow stick already.
Good?
Yeah.
Nachdem es jetzt scheinbar draußen stärker regnet, kommt jetzt mehr Wasser.
Okay, aber ist nicht schlimm.
Nein, normal nicht.
Kann die Decke jetzt nicht einstürzen?
Die Decke kann jederzeit einstürzen. Aber es wird nicht heute sein. Wow. Irre. Also ein bisschen gruselig ist es. Und es ist schon ziemlich stark, dass man so Dinge wie diesen Generator da findet.
Thomas is carrying a lot of light in his backpack. He wants to photograph what he finds after all. we delve even deeper into the cavern. 30 years ago, this was a highly modern aviation tunnel, and today, it's a dark cave. Up to 80 MiG fighter aircraft were stationed here. The cavern was even equipped to withstand a nuclear attack. After the facilities were blown up, the tunnel system was reportedly used by criminal organizations. What were they doing here?
Bist du deppert? Das dürfte dieses ominöse Schmugglerfahrzeug gewesen sein. Es gab ja in der Airbase, wie sie zugemacht worden ist, gab es ja noch Benzin und solche Dinge. Die sind Leute reingefahren und haben das ganze Zeug geklaut. Und das ist ihnen herinnen scheinbar komplett ausgebrannt.
And so smugglers hauled the last useful things out of the ruins. We don't know why the car was burned out. The car wreck is simply a brilliant motif for Thomas. The military base thus doubles as a photo studio. After 4 hours of darkness, we are glad nothing happened to us and to see the light of day again. There are no longer any aircraft in the old airbase, but Thomas has gotten a tip from the online community. There is supposedly still an old machine somewhere here on the military base. The whole team is on the lookout. A stroke of luck. Thomas is armed with a camera and a tripod. The aircraft appears to be an old troop carrier. The motif hunter is keen on climbing inside it now.
Geil. Ja, ziemlich kaputt, aber für mich sehr geil. Das ganze Cockpit ist noch da mit den ganzen Steuereinrichtungen und der Frachtraum ist auch super. Gibst du mir mal bitte das Stativ? Dankeschön.
We climb in after him. The aircraft is making us curious too.
Aufpassen mit den Nägeln da.
How long the machine has been standing here already? Why was it left behind? Thomas himself is not sure. The aircraft gives up very few of its secrets.
Das Flugzeug dürfte schon ein bisschen Geschichte haben. Man sieht da zum Beispiel Einschusslöcher. Vorne sind auch noch ein paar. Und es ist ein Transportflugzeug.
Urban exploring looks to us like a mixture of adventure playground and historical research.
Wieso ist denn hier kein Boden drin?
Wenn man sich das Cockpit ansieht, da fehlen ja auch schon sämtliche Instrumente.
Ja.
Da fehlt der Boden. Das heißt, irgendwelche Leute werden daherfahren, das ausbauen, weil sie es für sich selber brauchen.
Thomas is completely in his element here. The motif hunter would never take anything away from the places he explores, except photos. And he leaves nothing behind, except footprints. That is the urban explorer's code of honor.
Mir gefällt das ja voll, aber es ist halt schade um die Maschine an sich. Die gehört eigentlich eher in ein Museum oder restauriert, statt dass sie da verrottet. Also hat wirklich schade drum.
At least Thomas thoroughly documents the old heap. Thomas is satisfied with today's motif collection.
Es soll ja auch ein bisschen Abenteuer sein und das war es heute definitiv.
This mysterious place was also an impressive adventure for us. There are mysterious places in India too. For example, this village of bodybuilders. Asola Fatapur Beri, the strongest village in India. Six packs and biceps as far as the eye can see. How can this be? 6 o'clock in the morning, while priests lead morning prayers in the village temple, the men of the village gather to work out in what's known as the Akara. The men belong to a traditional Indian wrestling culture. Here, the battle arena is being prepared. Every morning, Ronek jogs the 6 kilometers to the Akara.
हमारा अखाड़ा है और अभी यहाँ पे हम रेसलिंग की ट्रेनिंग करते हैं सारे, सब बच्चे अभी एक्सरसाइज भी कर रहे हैं। ये हमारे कोच साहब है और ये हमारा फील्ड है हमारे अखाड़े का, और वही सब चीज़ें हैं, अभी स्टार्ट करेंगे वर्कआउट।
Ronek, one of the 800 men from Asola who take part in Akara culture. They're trained by the master, Vijay Pahelwan. The former pro wrestler is a sort of guru here. He teaches the traditional wrestling sport to the village men. The sport had actually died out in the 8th century. The reason for its newfound popularity.
रेसलिंग करने के लिए ये प्रॉपर एक्सरसाइज है, इससे अच्छा एक्सरसाइज कोई नहीं है। डंड मारना पहलवान के लिए मोस्ट इम्पोर्टेंट है, इसको मारना बहुत ही ज़रूरी होता है। अगर तब तक आप रेसलिंग करनी है और आपको आगे जाना तो डंड मारना बहुत ज़रूरी होता है।
For the boys of the village, Vijay kicked off a trend and became a role model to everyone here.
मैं बाउंसर बनना चाहता हूँ, मेरे भाई बाउंसर है इसलिए मैं बाउंसर बनना चाहता हूँ।
Training for the dream job, bouncer, twice a day, 7 days a week. Although a gym has since opened in the village, most people prefer to continue training in the old wrestling tradition.
बच्चे 15-16 साल की उम्र के बाद सारे लड़के हमारे इलाके में रेसलिंग करना शुरू हो जाता है। रस्सा भी करते हैं लड़के, रस्सा पहलवान के लिए बहुत जरूरी होता है।
The primary component of this training to be a bouncer is kushti, an ancient Indian form of wrestling on a dirt floor. The goal is to wrestle your opponent to the ground.
हमारी जॉब के लिए ट्रेनिंग है, कभी क्लब में कोई झगड़ा हो जाता है तो यहाँ पे ट्रेनिंग करने से वो सब चीज़ें हम अच्छे से हैंडल कर सकते हैं। यहाँ पे फिजिकल वर्क करके वहाँ पे फिजिकल हो जाते हैं, कभी लड़ाई वड़ाई हो गई।
But the training isn't always completely free of injuries.
जी इसी से ही रेसलर की पहचान होती है, इनके जो हमारे कान टूट जाते हैं तो इससे रेसलर की पहचान होती है।
Alongside the intense training, kushti wrestlers consider alcohol, drugs and meat taboo. All the men in the village are vegetarians.
ये बल्ली पहलवान है, ये बहुत अच्छा पहलवान के साथ साथ बहुत अच्छा बाउंसर भी है, ये बाउंसर की जॉब करता है और अपना सारा।
To build up enough muscle mass for their dream job, despite all this, Ronek and the others follow a strict diet. Alongside a huge quantity of fruit and homemade flatbread called naan, the muscle brothers consume 4 liters of dairy products every day. A steady supply is provided by their own cow.
ये हमारी बॉडी के लिए इसमें प्रोटीन ज़्यादा है, कैल्शियम है और फैट, जो गुड फैट है वो बहुत ज़्यादा मात्रा में है। अच्छी डाइट है, ये हमारे लिए हेल्दी फूड है, मतलब हेल्दी है ये दूध।
So this is what the dream job looks like. Ronek's shift begins at 10 o'clock in the evening, an hour's drive away from the village. Checking bags and IDs 4 times a week, the village wrestlers provide security at the club.
7-6 year, 5-6 years, we come to
As a bouncer, Ronek earns 800 euros a month. That's as much as the village farmers earn in an entire year. Our next stop on the hunt for the craziest villages in India, the village without doors. Shani Shignapur in northern India. At first glance, it looks like any typical Indian village. But something's off, something's missing. Doors. We can't find a single door in the whole town. Not even in the hospital or in the shops. Everywhere, empty door frames gape. Once in a while, a curtain serves as a door. Even the local hotel has none whatsoever. But why? Mama has lived in Shani Shignapur since he was born. The 63-year-old has never known life with doors. His 2-bedroom apartment only has empty door frames. Anybody could just waltz in here.
आमच्या गावाला देवाला मंदिर नाही आहे, देवाला मंदिर नाही तर घराला दरवाजे नाही आणि टाळे लावत नाही, इथे चोरीचा काही प्रश्न नाही.
But is that really true? And theft is one thing, but what about privacy? A simple curtain is all that protects from noise and view. It seems to be enough for Mama.
काही कपडे वगैरे जर चेंज करायचे असले तर असा पडदा लावून घ्यायचा, असं बंद करून कपडे वगैरे चेंज करतात.
The whole village behaves just like him. But on Mama's route to work, we notice another building after all, one with an open door, the bank. Shani Shignapur's bank has swinging doors, but no lock. Mama has no interest in this at all. In any case, he doesn't have any money in the bank. He keeps it at home, in his bag, and in his shop.
आम्ही असं घरी गेल्यानंतर असं दुकान असं उघडच असतं, काही चोरी वगैरेचे काही विषय नाही, चोरी वगैरे काही होत नाही, सर्व सामान असंच असतं. हे बघा, गल्ला हा सगळा उघडाच असतो, इथं काही चोरी वगैरे काही कोण करत नाही.
The reason for this freedom from theft, and thus for the missing doors, stands right next to Mama's souvenir shop, a temple. Local law has it that following a great flood centuries ago, a stone with the likeness of Shani washed up at the location of what is now the village without doors, and it was bleeding. No one could move it. It was clear that the deity himself had come to earth in this stone.
इथे शनिदेवाचं संरक्षण असल्यामुळे चोरी वगैरे काही होत नाही. हां, शनिदेवाचं संरक्षण आहे, त्याच्यामुळे इथं गावात कुठल्याही प्रकारची चोरी वगैरे काही होत नाही. त्याला शनिदेवाचं संरक्षण असतं.
That's why the town's chief of police has the easiest job in the world.
मी सिक्युरिटी ऑफिसर आहे शनि शिंगणापूर देवस्थान ट्रस्ट. इथे चोरी वगैरे काही होत नाही किंवा झाली नाही.
That sounds too good to be true. Do the people here really trust each other that much? We accompany Mama until he closes up shop. We want to know, what does he do with the money he earned today? And we can hardly believe our eyes.
हे लहानपणापासून आम्ही बचपणापासून इथं असताना, हे भरपूर दिवसापासून आम्ही इथं राहतो, आमचे आई वडील सुद्धा इथं राहतात.
Unbelievable. A village without doors. Because nobody needs them here. Our next stop on the hunt for the craziest villages in India, the twin village. Kodini, 400 kilometers south of Bangalore. For centuries, this remote village has displayed a phenomenon that has stumped researchers and biologists. Twins, and lots of them. Over 600 twins come from this village of barely 2,000 inhabitants. That's 10 times more twins than the rest of the world. It's 7 o'clock in the morning. For identical twins Adi and Juza, the day begins like every day with their morning routine. The 12-year-old brothers are one of hundreds of pairs of twins in their village. Born with the same DNA, they are easily mistaken for one another. In the neighboring house, Mulen and Mulan are still bathing. They are also 12 years old and identical twins. Mulan and Mulen eat a traditional Indian breakfast, chai, with cookies. Hey, they've chosen the same cookie. That also happens to other twins around the world. But how is this extreme amount possible in one village? Eight o'clock. School is starting. Of the 500 students at the Kodinis village school, 72 are twins. Normally, the probability is just 1.6%. Here, it's 16%. For teacher Ranji, working at the school is a challenge. Because in this class alone, there are three pairs of twins.
There is a mela, mela type.
I see.
Mela. So many melas are there. Mm-hmm. Mela, Kala mela. So many students are there. Mm-hmm. And the number of things.
Genealogists have discovered that the twin boom in Cordini began about three generations ago. At 91, Besha Loha is the oldest twin in the village. In the last 10 years, the number of twin births has even doubled. The village residents believe there's something in the drinking water. Everyone drinks the water from their household wells, unfiltered. A comprehensive study should bring some answers in the next few years. Until then, the twin boom will remain a mystery in this small Indian village. We're traveling to China, from India to the province of Chongqing. 1,700 kilometers away, here among the mountains, we're searching for this so-called fire village. We ask at this hospital.
Oh, this fire is the fire of the fire. 正好我要到那里去出征，你们要到那里去吗？ 那我带你们去，好不好？好，走吧。We
follow the doctor. The village is difficult to get to and almost completely cut off from the outside world. After endless mountain passes, we finally reach a remote settlement. The air smells distinctly burnt.
我的货在我后院过来去看，我后院过来走进去看。
Behind the house, the smell is even more extreme. Mo Wang wants to show us that the ground is truly on fire here with the help of a lighter. Unbelievable. Everywhere, as if by an invisible hand, areas of the ground around his house start to catch fire. The flames leap up to a meter high. Immense heat rises from the earth. Even without open fire, leaves immediately burst into flames. How is this even physically possible? After all, the ground is damp. Farmer Mo remembers how it all started. In the meantime, the government has also taken notice and even installed warning signs. It doesn't make a difference to Mo Wang. The village in China isn't the only place in the world where the ground burns like this. For example, in Turkmenistan, in Derwezi in the Karakum Desert, an accident took place while drilling for natural gas, creating a 70-meter large crater. Its fire has been burning uninterrupted for 40 years. Leave this village? For corn farmer Mo Wang, despite the enormous danger, it's out of the question. His family has lived here for three generations.
那个是马丢针头来围的时候，那个围起，哎，那个火啊，是从针头那个那种围起来的，我们那个包裹，那个烧了生化，一个是怕人呢有生命问题要来看那些把围起来，就是说我们那些烧了都不可能是庄稼。Farmer
Mo and the other village residents have made the best of a bad situation. Instead of allowing the gas to simply burn off, for around 200 euros, the enterprising Chinese man has attached equipment that allows him to siphon off the gas. Using an electric air pump, the fire farmer sucks the highly inflammable gas from the earth and stores it in a large balloon. An extremely dangerous business opportunity. What's more, it's absolutely illegal in China. Just how dangerous it really easily becomes clear when after a few seconds the hose catches on fire.
<音><音>
All that with a lit cigarette in his mouth. It seems he doesn't understand the danger presented by the gas under his house. To test which of the many cracks in the ground is leaking gas, he ignites the gas source without further ado. This makes our team a little uneasy. Farmer Mo isn't the only person in the region for whom the gas is a source of income. We show what we filmed to a firefighter in Chongqing.
地下因为它地下有从就是它自然的气体甲烷在上面它自然生成的很容易造成爆炸那个伤人事故所以是采非法采集是危险的
But where is the gas even coming from? The theory: there is a large gas deposit beneath the region. The next refinery is more than 100 kilometers away from our burning village. So far, so good. If it weren't for the quarries, they're located just a few kilometers away from the farmer Mo's village. The problem: the rock is cleared using explosives. It may be that the detonations caused cracks in the ground, through which large amounts of methane gas now suddenly reach the surface unchecked. We make endless phone calls to public authorities and government agencies in order to confirm this theory. Yet no one wants to give us answers. The fire village in Sichuan seems to be a taboo subject. Ever since the fire started burning in Wang's garden, the doctor has visited weekly. Dizziness can be an early warning sign of unconsciousness. But that's not an option for farmer Wang. He and his family earn 300 euros every month through selling gas, a decent extra income for the otherwise very poor rural inhabitants. The government is the thorn in their side. It would prefer to keep the mysterious gas deposit secret.
Okay. Police?
The situation is getting serious. Our team is questioned for 2 hours. Background checks and licenses are brought in. All of this is only for our own safety, they tell us. After long discussions, the officials escort us out of the village. The camera has to stay turned off. We leave the village. Farmer Wang and his family remain. 2 weeks later, the farmer tells us by phone that the flow of gas from the ground has become even stronger. But Wang doesn't want to leave his home. We're crossing our fingers that he doesn't come to regret this decision someday. Mystery places.